Hello, my friends. Welcome to Breakfast with Sergio. Let me ask you a question. Do you have the creative gene? Well, in today's episode, we're going to find out, because with me, I have Rose Gabler, and we're going to talk about her brand new book, The Creative Gene. So don't miss it. It's going to be awesome. Well, my friends, welcome back to Breakfast with Sergio. Super excited because I'm here with Rose. Good to see you.
Good to see you. Thank you for having me.
Welcome to the Jovier Center.
Yeah, I'm very excited to be here. It's beautiful.
Absolutely. Well, I'm super excited because we're going to talk about today the creative gene,
yes.
Right? And I think for us as artists, we assume like, well, I do have the creative gene. I make art. But in this case, you know, your approach is looking at the five universal traits to spark success. You know, so
yes.
Let's talk about how, you know, the creative gene sparks success and how as artists we can employ that. So, but before we do that, I would love to know a little bit about your background, right? Because books come to us, but they all have always a back end story,
yes,
right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So Rose, tell us a little bit about, you know, you as a person, how did you came into art?
Sure. So art has been part of my life since I was born. I was basically molded, for lack of better terms, to be in this field. My grandfather is was an artist from the south side of Chicago, Matt Lamb.
Amazing artist.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. And so he obviously instilled in me a lot of artistic inspiration and spirituality mm-hmm. through that method. However, before he was an artist, he mm-hmm. actually owned the largest chain of funeral homes in the Midwest,
right.
Which is crazy. And when he turned 40, he didn't feel well one day and went in to go and get a medical checkup and was told he had a rare type of cancer and was going to die within months.
Right.
So he decided at that point that if he lived through the disease, that he was going to sell all of his funeral homes and start painting for peace, hope, and love.
Uh-huh.
And he went and got a second opinion, and they said, you have mono, not cancer. So
big difference, right?
Big difference, big difference. Yeah. So he sold all of his funeral homes and started painting for peace, hope, and love.
Mm-hmm.
So I came from a family where, like, as I said, the life was associated with art and creativity,
right.
And business was literally associated with death.
Right.
So I did not ever put the two together. I always kept them separate. And that was not until later in life when I started trying to find that connection. You know,
okay.
How can we use creative elements in a business mindset, in an mm-hmm. entrepreneurial way, in order to achieve success?
Mm-hmm.
And started doing this research and background information from my personal experiences
right.
and from professionals in industries across the world
right.
to find out what those commonalities could be.
Right, that's exciting. And also, you know, besides growing up in a family with art being part of the daily conversation, also mm-hmm. you yourself, you study art history,
yes.
Business,
mm-hmm.
you were an art dealer.
Yes.
So tell me a little bit just about that part too.
Yeah, so I studied art history and international business at North Central College.
Okay.
And then I went on and got my master's degree in business of arts and culture. But I had been representing my grandfather's art professionally since I was 15.
Wow.
So I traveled the world representing his art uh-huh. in different countries, from Luxembourg, Argentina, the UAE, England, France, Germany, Spain, and the list goes on. So he gave me quite the education of experience,
uh-huh.
and I was able to translate that into another professional realm of being an art dealer on cruise ships. So I continue to travel, continue
yeah.
to sell art, and I just love the whole environment that creativity brings to people everywhere.
Right. That's awesome. And that brings us to this book, The Creative Gene, which is now available.
Yes.
Right? It just became available in just a couple weeks ago, right?
Yeah,
right.
In May.
Mm-hmm. In May. Super. So now it's available, and you guys can get it. We're going to put a link also in the description. So tell me about the arriving to this book idea, right?
Sure.
So you've been thinking about creativity.
Mm-hmm.
And as you're growing up, as you're working with your grandfather and as you yourself, you know, as a self-interest, and you start speaking with people also. And we all have heard like the term of, I'm not creative.
Right.
I'm not creative. And I think also, you know, in recent years, I read also a lot of business books, you know, how mm-hmm. creativity is such a big part of the business today and
mm-hmm.
thinking creatively and things like that with teams and things like that. So tell me, you know, as you're arriving to like putting together this book, what was like the thing that you wanted to answer for people or help people with, you know, as you wrote this?
Sure. So if I were to ask every single person that walked into the Juby Gallery what creativity means to them,
uh-huh.
everybody would say something different.
Right.
I have interviewed hundreds of people on this topic, and I have yet to get the exact same answer twice.
Right.
So it's this idea that everybody knows about, that everybody talks about, that is so present in our lives on a daily basis, and it's one of the most desired skills in the workforce today. But nobody actually knows what it is. Like, there's not one common definition or understanding for what creativity is for everybody. So I was really on a search to find out what makes creativity so universal. Why is it so important to humanity and humankind and societies in general to be creative when nobody explains it the same way? Like, how can we hold each other to the same standards or the same expectations? So it set me out on this journey of, like, the past couple of years where I interview people on creativity in different realms, such as teachers, accountants, scientists, the list goes on, and just tried to find out what how they experience creativity in their lives. And then try to also understand how they implemented it throughout their day-to-day lives as well.
So that led you to find these five universal traits, you know, as you dissect each of the conversations and the research. You know, there's like these five commonalities, that, well, can you share a little bit about what those are, what those fives are?
So throughout the conversations, I did listen for key directions, key contributing factors that were describing what creativity was. And the first one that came up, of course, is life experience. How you experience creativity throughout your life and in what elements. Your expertise, what you professionally study and what you spend your life devoted to. Your environment, how your surroundings impact your creative adventure and exploration. Your ability to be flexible. Because creativity is always changing and evolving.
Especially now with the pandemic, everybody has to be flexible, right?
Perfect example,
Exactly.
And then your grit, how hard you're willing to work at it. Because creativity is not, it's not magic. You know, it's something you have to work at. It's something that you have to continue. It's a muscle. So the more that you utilize all five aspects of these contributing factors, I have found that the more alignment people have found between creativity and their professional success.
And there has been so many books written about each of those individual aspects, like that you're looking at them all together under the umbrella of, of being creative, how did you find, in the case of, you know, success is also a big word,
It is,
It's a big section in the in any bookstore, right? So how do you find, again, that connectivity between being creative and being successful? That are they, you know, how do they relate to each other?
So in my book, I also talk about how difficult it is to define this word. Because there are other words that are similar to this as well in our society. And so I personally went in and defined what success could be in this journey specifically of the creativity gene and finding alignment professionally. So for this book, I go towards success as finding actionable alignment with your goals. So that's my personal definition of success in this book, because again, it's subjective. But what I personally think about creativity and its connection to success is that creativity requires us to be so genuine and authentic that it's hard to achieve success without utilizing it in this way.
No, that's awesome. It's something that, you know, I often talk here with our friends about, you know, the importance of goal setting and focusing and alignment, you know, and those things. And, you know, you and I were talking a little bit before the chat, you know, how oftentimes we think of ourselves as artists as, you know, I'm very creative in the studio, but then when it comes to our business practices, everything that happens outside, you know, to get our artwork from the studio into the world, that's where sometimes we have the disconnect, right? And like, I don't feel creative about my marketing or this or that. But do you think that, you know, this creativity that happens in the studio can also help us to succeed in the business world?
100% Yes, of course it can. Creativity is one of the most sought after aspects in business itself. So the fact that like you already realize and accept it and know that you have the creative gene within
you.
Exactly. Then you can basically adapt your mindset into that business mode. Mm-hmm. And it's a very difficult process to achieve, especially right. for artists who, like in art school, we were also talking about, you're not taught how to build a business. You're right. taught how to explore your creativity and how to master it.
Right.
And so that's where the disconnect is. So right. for the actionable aspect of the creativity gene, I recommend also continuing on with focusing that that creative mindset in flexibility in your business, okay. in your okay. business goals.
Right.
And finding out what genuinely speaks to your creative values.
Super. That's exciting. And by the way, we're going to do a second episode because yeah. it's such a great conversation. So this kind of first episode gives us a bit of an introduction into the book. In the second episode, I would like to go a little bit more in depth on this particular last conversation that we had.
Yeah.
And but before we cut on this one, we want our friends to make sure to tune in and watch the second part number two of this conversation is, you know, after you wrote this book, and with your story of, you know, knowing your grandfather, which for me was a great surprise because I admire your grandfather's story as an art student. I actually met Matt Lamb. So it was super exciting. Now, even now the conversation is even more exciting for me on a personal level. So, you know, now you wrote this book, right? The Creative Gene, everything that you have learn about art and the art world and things like that. If you look back at the history of your grandfather, he becoming a very successful artist, you know, a self-taught artist in the real sense of a self-taught artist right. before the internet and social media and YouTube audiences and things like that, right? As you look back at his career and his life, you know, how do you see this being part of his success?
See the creativity gene as part of his success?
Yes.
He was creative his whole life and just didn't realize it. You know, he actually took the funeral home business and like tripled it, quadrupled it, and expanded it into different states nationwide. Like, so he was always using his creativity, but didn't acknowledge it. He didn't use the word creativity for what he was doing. He like associated with entrepreneurship,
right?
You know, and it wasn't until he finally had this death sentence that he was like, why am I associating all my creative like energy to like death when I could be using it to fuel life?
Right.
And so that's where his creativity finally made that jump to his genuine creative self.
Absolutely. And then as he ran then his career as an artist, then also using that creativity in a whole new art world, which for him was foreign.
Very.
Because he didn't come from the art world
at all. Yeah.
So using also these creative gene ideas and aspects to build up a brand new career at an older age, which is a whole new ballgame.
Totally.
It is hard to build an art career, you know, of any age, you
know,
even if you come from art school, you know, let alone if you come from a totally different industry, self-taught, in a world before the internet, and then, you know, Bill did what he did, which was amazing.
Yeah.
Well, that's super exciting, Rosa. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for, you know, your time. I think this kind of gives us a great taste into going into the second episode, so make sure you guys, make sure you check it out. And of course, in between episodes, go and get your book, The Creative Gene. Where can our friends find it?
Amazon.
So just go to Amazon.com, super easy. And where can our friends find you also on social media if they want to learn more about you, about the book, and things like that?
Sure, yeah. I'm on Instagram, Rose Gabb, or The Creativity Gene. I also have an account for that. And my website is rosegabler.com.
Excellent. Well, my friends, thanks so much for joining us today. Thank you, Rose.
Thank you.
We'll see you in the next episode.
Sounds good.
Don't go too far.
Okay.
Take care, my friends. Do us a big favor. Please share this episode with all your friends and get the book. It's going to be awesome. Have a great day. Bye.